We have three papers today, including the government's paper, Ms. S. Mak's letter, and a background brief by the Secretariat. I now invite the administration in. We would also invite the deputations in. I'd like to introduce the officers for today. We have Ms. Sandy Chan, Undersecretary for Constitutional and Mainland Affairs, Mr. Cheng Toi Cheng, Principal Assistant Secretary, Ms. Teresa Chan, Principal Assistant Secretary from the Education Bureau, Mr. Cheng Kwan Yam, Chief Executive Officer from DHAD, from the Hospital Authority, Mr. Hans Lee, from we also have Dr. Kelly So, Principal Medical and Health Officer, Department of Health. Dr. Francis Wong, Director, Hong Kong Institute of Construction. Dr. Ma Chi, Deputy Executive Director from the Employees Retraining Board, and Professor Ronald Chong from the VTC. Welcome. I also call to members' attention and the intention of the public. Note for members of the public attending meetings in conference rooms or observing meetings in public galleries in the Legislative Complex. We first invite Mr. Andy Chan, the Undersecretary, to speak. I'd like to welcome everyone to the meeting. Today is both a meeting and an open hearing, and we submitted a paper to the subcommittee, and I'd like to brief you on this paper. The government's policy on ethnic minorities is very clear, and that is we want to eliminate discrimination and promote equal opportunities. In the policy address announced last October, the chief executive spoke at length on the government's work on the rights of ethnic minorities, and there were four paragraphs. Today, we will be discussing the administrative guidelines and how it can be improved. Apart from the guidelines, we are also carrying out legislative work. And for the race discrimination ordinance, review is already underway. And 2 months ago, we discussed with members how our work can be further improved. We will seek to work on the priority areas suggested by the Equal Opportunities Commission, and for the rest, we will continue to review the issues. Apart from legislation, there's also publicity work. So we also collaborate with the EOC. Since 3 years ago, we have been allocating an annual funding of $4.5 million to the EOC, and the EOC set up an ethnic minorities unit equipped with full-time staff, and the unit would promote equal opportunities for EMs. Apart from the annual recurrent funding, since 3 years ago, we offered an extra allocation of 2 million, and another 3 million will be allocated this year. As for the translation and interpreting services, we invited the EOC to study whether standard certification procedures could be established for translation and interpretation. So you can see that the government is not relying on administrative guidelines alone in promoting the rights of EMs. So we are also conducting publicity with the EOC. The administrative guidelines have been in place for 8 years already. And it's time to review how the guidelines could be further improved. The current term government is committed to improving the administrative guidelines. So through the discussion today, the government would take in various views so that our review work later this year could be improved. We have a lot of government representatives today. We have reps from 10 departments, and we want to hear from you. So please offer your views so that we can improve.
Right, Abbott of the Catholic Workers Center, please. So you have 3 minutes, please.
Okay. Thank you, Chairman. As the paper provided by the administration has a substantial part mentioning about provision of interpretation services to EMs, today I would like to focus more on it and explain how ineffective it was implemented. Language barrier is one of the biggest reasons for inaccessibility. Why we always insist on interpretation service? Because it is the only way to solve the language problem. Experience showed that the most of the staff is ignorant and they are reluctant to use interpretation services. I want to quote one case here. An EM from Nepali background, along with our center's EM staff, visited Yao Chim Mong Security Field Unit of SWD to apply for the old age allowance. EM staff helped the client to book interpretation service, but the Social Security Field Unit staff refused to arrange and told the applicant to wait. After waiting for 20 minutes, when they called the applicant to the counter, they didn't book any interpretation service. When the EM staff again insisted to arrange interpretation service and presented the sample notice issued by SWD, which states clearly, if you would like to use telephone interpretation service for specific languages, please tell our intake worker or responsible case worker for arrangement. But still, the staff claimed that SWD cannot provide interpretation service, and he denied the interpretation arrangement mentioned in the guideline that it is not for SWD staff, rather than it is for interpretation service provider. So if applicant needs interpretation, he should go to the interpretation service providers. Furthermore, the staff also mentioned that SWD simply helps interpretation service providers to keep their service information in the Social Security Field Unit, but they cannot arrange interpretation service because staff thinks that they don't have enough resources to arrange such service. After continuously insisting for 2 hours, interpretation was at last declined, and the EM staff has to help the applicant to complete the application procedure. This case is only the tip of an iceberg. I think not only our center, but also other NGOs with the delegate sittings here have a lot of these kinds of cases on hand. It is sad, but it is true, so we should explore means to make sure that interpretation will be provided to not only those who cannot speak neither Chinese nor English, but also those who do not have confidence to understand the complicated administrative procedure due to language barriers. Thus, a standard guideline and procedures for interpretation service for all government departments is essential. In it, some elements elements should be included. Number one is a number of questions to assess the client's language proficiency and so to identify their genuine needs for interpretation. Number two, there should be clear steps for frontline staff that how they can clarify and address the reasons when interpretation service is refused by the client so as to make sure that the clients understand their rights before they make any decision. We hope that CMAB will step up to draw up a step-by-step guide on using interpretation, and most importantly, it should be made important and essential part of the guidelines.
Thank you.
Next, Mr. Lam Kwok Hong, well, as the lady just now made it very clear, that is when you told LegCo, it actually never happened in reality, because while I was a lawmaker, I was told that interpretation service was provided very extensively, and of course the hospital authority has done the best job amongst everybody else. Alright, you said that you had a dedicated unit, some 23 departments have been covered, but then what about the remaining 13? So is it that it's too small a room? So how come we don't have everybody else here? So there were 23 departments, so as the Bureau, well, how can you call upon the other departments to do what you tell them? So either you have the CS for administration or you have the CE to tell them what they should be doing. So either you ask Matthew Chang to set up a dedicated task force on the rights for ethnic minority groups. So using your platform will simply not be able to command all the 23 departments and bureaus. Are you assuming that you are Han Xin, the general who was able to give instructions to all the army? So, sorry, you're just a small department, you're just a bureau. So other than your ability to disqualify me and also to ban me from standing in an election, you are not able to do anything else. So you have not been able to deliver what you preach. In fact, back in 2009, when you introduced legislation, and a year later, you came up with this guideline, and it's been 8 years. So your review has been lousy, because when I joined the council, I asked you two things. Number one, I asked you, well, did you keep any records? No, you didn't have any records. Then how can we monitor your performance? So you did not give any instruction to the 23 departments and bureaus to keep the records. So without such records, then how can you be accountable? So it's like Theresa Chang. Without her making the declaration, then how can she be accountable? So she just be shifting the focus onto something else. So when will you be completing all the guidelines? Well, that was in 2017 when the question was put to you. And also, when you were asked with regard to the review of the administrative guidelines, can they be uploaded online so that people could take a look? Well, it's been 3 years, so that was back in 2014. So it was a call for the review of the administrative review. That was the time when I was still a lawmaker. So you didn't have any figures. You had information that has not been uploaded online. So Mr. Chen, your Chinese name suggests that you are a good-looking gentleman, but when will you be able to give me a reply? So when can you respond to my question? So when are you going to respond to my call? So can you address the issue?
Hussein of the Equal Access Group, please.
Thank you, Chairman. As a member of and working for ethnic minorities for last 5 years, my observation and experiences clearly indicate ineffectiveness and even failure of implementing administrative guidelines across different public service providers. Due to time constraint here today, I would like to quote two cases that occurred last month that show failure of housing authority with this regard. Case number one, an ethnic minority applicant went to apply for public housing at sub-office of Housing Authority known as Information Center. The applicant was rejected to provide interpretation service upon explicit request, with the reason provided by the staff that the office is too small to have interpretation service. Actually, free interpretation service could be used, but the staff continued to explain in English about the application procedures and the relevant documents needed, while the applicant could not understand anything at all. Was housing staff too naive or insensitive to the needs of ethnic minority client. Another case, an applicant went to apply for public housing, and at this time it was Housing Authority Customer Service Center. She was born in Hong Kong and returned after 3 years due to her studies, which changed her resident status from right of abode to right to land. HA staff rejected to accept her application and sent her twice to Immigration Department to obtain evidence to prove her residential status. In fact, her identity card clearly mentioned R, representing that she has right to land in Hong Kong, and moreover, her birth certificate was also attached with the application. Was the housing staff being prejudiced or discriminatory, or was he insensitive and oblivious towards the different types of residential status when handling ethnic minorities application? On one hand, we really hope that the housing department can respond to these two cases, but at the same time, these cases and many other cases alike are clearly evident that there should be more that administration should do to implement, monitor and review administrative guidelines, as well as the checklist to measure for promoting racial equality and equal accessibility to all public service providers for ethnic minorities. First, we echo with equal opportunities recommendation that a system of a regular structured monitoring which persuades relevant authorities to set goals and report continuously, consultation with relevant stakeholder and collecting pertinent information and statistics while assessing the impact of policies and measures. Secondly, as mentioned by the paper provided by the administration, that the review should be conducted soon to explore feasibility of drawing up standard guidelines and procedures for interpretation services. Some of the elements should have been included in the guideline as mentioned by the earlier speakers. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Hussein. 跟着我们请听...
Next, we have Mr. Zhang from the Christian Social Service. Well, the paper is about promoting racial equality so that there will be equal access to public services. So I'd like to focus on the Labor Department's checklist on measures, because the checklist says that different ethnic minority groups' needs and sensitivity issues will have to be taken into account. And we've also looked at the Labor Department's guidelines. For example, a special counter will be set up, and employers will also be encouraged to lower their language proficiency requirements and so on. So I'd like to give you specific examples. Well, the Labor Department claimed that they have a dedicated counter, and they would also be speaking in English to the job seekers. But then I'd just like to say that EM groups need to be understood in terms of their cultural background, their religious background, and also there needs to be specific job matching service before they can establish this collaboration or cooperation relationship with the authorities. But then the administrations fail in this regard, according to many job seekers. When they said that they'd like to seek certain jobs, and they just use the computer to help them find the jobs without really helping them matching their skills with certain jobs. For example, if they want to change to higher skill jobs, they notice that nobody was there to help. For example, life planning and assessment and planning, and also there is no one there to help them ease the problems between their potential employers and them. And next is about language problems. Well, yes, interpretation services is available, but in 2017, some 2,844 job seekers were told that they could make use of the service. There were only 20 occasions when such service was made available to them. And when we asked some service users, they said that many EMs thought that they would be charged for the service, and they were also concerned that if they really use the service, the employers might not be prepared to hire them, and therefore the Labor Department should have an established procedures requiring the staff to introduce such services to the job seekers with very clear language, and they should also lower the Chinese proficiency requirement, because for EMs, their unemployment rate is somewhat higher than the average citizens, and well, the success rate was 19.6% for average citizens, but then for ethnic minority groups, it's just 7.8%, so it's a lot lower. That's for 2016. And when they failed to find jobs, and the Labour Department also did not offer them with other schemes, for example, like the middle-wage job-seeking schemes and also other incentives to employers so that employers would have the incentive to hire them. And we believe that that's the problem with the existing policy. What's even more serious is that because of such a lack of knowledge and understanding of the EMs, employers would have a lot of suspicion in hiring EMs, and they would not have sufficient confidence. That's why there should be long-term tracking, so that they would be monitoring the progress of such EM workers. For example, they can also make reference to the Chin Shui Wai experience, and also other groups are doing the same for EMs, so that there can be personalized job matching service for them. Next, Ms. Law from the HKCSS. In fact, certain functions are not included under the RDO. That's why in 2010, the administration introduced the administrative guidelines. Regrettably, this is just implemented on a voluntary basis, and in fact, they have not been able to coordinate and monitor the implementation of this as far as the way it is implemented. That's why many people have not been able to access such services. Yes, at present, some 23 government departments and bureaus have accepted that, but then they have really not come up with relevant measures and policies under the guidelines, and they've also not consulted the views of the stakeholders, and they've also not collected relevant information on a regular basis. Such information was never released to the public. And also, in providing public services to the EMs, very few of them would use interpretation service. Only 12 interpretation services were organized or arranged by the housing department. So when compared to the number of use, it's very low. And the education department or bureau also has such guidelines, but then many kindergartens refuse to accept non-Chinese speaking students. And also some would also require them to be proficient in Cantonese. That's why they find it difficult to integrate into mainstream schools. And they've also got visual aid, but then many schools have not used that, and there has been no breakthrough whatsoever, and that's done by the SWD. And there are very few people who have used interpretation service. Some frontline staff would also require them to take their family members along so that they can provide interpretation service. That's why four suggestions are now made by us. First, the CS for administration to coordinate and monitor the implementation of the guidelines to ensure that all departments and bureaus would implement this. And all departments would also have to come up with relevant measures, and they should also regularly consult the stakeholders from EM groups, and they should also provide regular progress reports. And also, we should also develop a systematic and professional interpretation service. We should offer professional training, and there should also be recognition of the qualification, and we should also have guidelines for the interpreters, and there should also be performance pledges, and we should also collect the feedback from the users, and on a regular basis, the administration should also announce the number of times that the service has been used and how effective it has been. And also, we should step up training in terms of cultural sensitivity and so on. All frontline workers of government departments and bureaus should receive training so that they can have better understanding of the needs of the EM groups. Now, finally, there should be more public education and publicity. The administration should publicize the guidelines so that EMs would understand their rights better, and there would also be a better chance for them to build an equal and integrated society. We also hope that this meeting can be held earlier, because we simply do not have enough time, and we might have to end our meeting by 7, and if you can start the meeting at 2:30, that might be a lot better. Thank you. Well, because we have a very tight schedule, that's why we'll try our best. Next, Ms. Fu Hiu Lam from the Islands District Council. Thank you. I believe language proficiency has been something that has been preventing many EMs from integrating into society. And if you look at government's policies, well, EMs have not been given sufficient support. For example, at public hospitals, there are no resident interpreters to help the EMs by providing interpretation service. As a result of that, many senior citizens from EMs would not go to public hospitals or clinics for treatment. And even under the senior citizen health healthcare voucher scheme, they would not use them, and they have not been able to get relevant healthcare services because of language problems, and there might also be delay in treatment. Well, since September last year, the administration deployed interpreters to the Shin Kong Wui Mak Lee Ho's center, or Lady Mak Lee Ho center, to provide on-site and also telephone interpretation service. But then it was only tried out for a year, and then for the EMs, the effectiveness has yet to be proven. In the long run, I believe that the administration should provide training for more interpreters who should be stationed at hospitals, and they'd also be able to provide more telephone and on-site services, and that the policy should be made more systematic, and DHA should also set up EM interpretation department at hospitals so that interpreters will be able to provide on-site interpretation service. That would also go a long way in helping the EMs in solving these problems.
In terms of welfare and labor, last May, the labor department introduced some centers or employment in Wan Sum in Tin Shui Wai and Kowloon West, and they employed employment assistants to help EMs. But since these service stops are only pilot in basis, we hope that this such services could be extended to all job centers in order to facilitate EMs. As for the telephone interpretation services provided by the SWD, I hope that the government can set up dedicated units or simultaneous interpretation service for EMs. Finally, I suggest the government to set up a diversity committee to provide one-stop support to EMs in aspects such as learning, religious worship, etc. And this is Kayla Tam from Hong Kong Unison. Thank you, Chairman. Today, I'd like to point out a fundamental flaw of the administrative guidelines. The guidelines are based on a flawed assumption, and it assumes that the RDO and the Hong Kong Bills of Rights Ordinance would provide racial parity, and in theory, there would be a deterrent effect. But if there are judicial reviews on the grounds of the RDO or HK BOLO, there would be a heavy burden on the EMs. Under the RDO, well, it does not include the government's responsibilities, even though it includes some areas such as provision of goods, facilities and services and premises. In a case in 2016, we can see that 27 of the RDO might not encompass all government activities. So even with the ordinances in place, we cannot see how they would provide checks and balances for the government. So where is the deterrent effect? You talked about publicity and education efforts, but legal protection is a crucial part to maintaining equal opportunity. So we have to enhance the powers and scope of the EOC, and the RDO should be amended as soon as possible. And the part 6 and 23 of the EOC's recommendation report should be incorporated. The government said they would devote substantial resources in promoting equality in public bodies, but they cited the administrative guidelines, but they should actually come up with substantial measures for education. With Chinese learning and integration issues, a lot of EMs are living in poverty, and we are unable to utilize their talents. If the government has the responsibility to facilitate or promote equality in public bodies, So racial equality should not be a burden but a right. The United Nations would scrutinize the progress of Hong Kong in ISO and ICCPR, so the government should work doubly hard. Thank you very much, Ms. Tam. Mr. Mak Mei-kuen from the Annoy Tong Community Center. I work in a community center, so I'd like to share my experience on a community level. In the government's paper, we can see that the government invests a lot of resources every year on EMs. But we look forward to a holistic policy and policy indicators. Apparently, the government invests a lot of resources, but how can we evaluate the work? And secondly, a lot of people told us that they cannot see the services despite the resources or funds allocated by the government. And in schools, the EOC issued guidelines that interviews might not necessarily be arranged in Cantonese, but in reality, interviews are always conducted in Cantonese. So there is actually a gap, so to speak. So that's why policy objectives are very important. Currently, different bureaus and departments are working hard, and some are ahead of others. For example, the police, correctional services department, etc. They often stress that they have new recruits who are EMs. So I just wonder whether these departments are an exception rather than rule. So consistency is very important. Earlier, we went on a study tour in Singapore, and the practitioners there were talking about racial harmony. They have important policies and laws to promote equality. So if this is I think it's important we promote this in Hong Kong as well. Thirdly, in terms of education, young people enjoy a lot of learning opportunities, but for non-Chinese speaking persons, they would be unable to take part in a lot of programs or courses. So how can we ensure that they can all learn? When we were young, we studied in an English secondary school, but the teachers would still speak in Cantonese, and that would be hugely helpful. Some universities ask about our mainstreaming services, so we'd like to know the outcome of such. Thank you. Mr. Phoon Wing Lok, thank you very much, Chairman and Vice Chairman, for extending the work of this subcommittee by a year, so that we can offer our views. I really treasure this opportunity. I've been here twice last year, but there weren't a lot of time last year for questions and answers. So I'd like to raise my concerns. We only have about 2 hours or so, and we have 20 officials. Do we have enough time? So hopefully we can have a longer session next time. Starting from 2010, the administrative guidelines have been in place for almost 8 years. So in terms of execution, there are doubts whether they are really effective or whether the scope is adequate. Some practitioners said that at a Yamate service unit, there's no simultaneous or there's no interpretation service. And at other facilities, interpretation could not be provided. And in notices issued by school councils, they would always have to be translated. So are schools given enough resources to do so, or are the guidelines effectively enforced? And some departments are not included. For example, the Urban Renewal Authority. A lot of tenants and members of the public do not understand their rights, and they could be evicted. They might be evicted very quickly. So is there a translation and interpretation service for them? So hopefully the CMAB can play a stronger role as coordinator. So I have two short-term and two medium-term measures. In the short run, specific guidelines and promises should be provided. For example, school notices or school circulars should be bilingual, and telephone interpretation and visual aids should be proactively provided. And when the simultaneous interpreting service has to be requested, etc. When I met the Labor Department, they said that gathering data would constitute discrimination. And I realized that a lot of countries collect data on race. And the Ontario Human Rights Commission in Canada stipulate that data must be collected regularly, or else the government cannot monitor the services provided. And secondly, I support Ms. Alice Mack's recommendation of introducing a commissioner for diversity and EMs, and there should be enough manpower resources. Amending the RDO is certainly important. And there is a public sector equality duty. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Poon.
Raman, please.
Dear Chairman and honored government officials, I am Raman Lamia Shreya. I'm currently studying at the University of Hong Kong, a year three student, double majoring in American Studies and Criminology. Today, I would like to bring forth the issue of racial profiling by the police towards the ethnic minority community in Hong Kong through ID checks and body searches. Many of us youths and people of older generations experience such profiling on a first-hand basis when we're stopped by the police to conduct frequent ID checks and body searches, especially on South Asians and Africans in particular. We know that the police is granted the authority to stop and search us under the Police Force Ordinance, Public Order Ordinance, and the Immigration Ordinance. But it cannot be denied that when youngsters like us are stopped, we feel very humiliated because of the attitude of the police and how they treat us. They treat us like suspected criminals, especially in the streets of Chim Sa Choi, Sham Shui Po, Mong Kok, and Yuen Long because of a certain way that we look. We face the issue of who to complain to when we face such issues, and those people who do complain believe that no action will be taken ultimately because they are being stopped and searched even when there is no crime. This particular example further exhibits a stereotype that ethnic minorities within the community are prone to be criminals, because I can tell you for sure that not all ethnic minorities are criminals. Till this date, there is no official statistics to support whether this is a trend, because the police do not maintain figures of arrest as a result of stop and search actions. Instead, such form of racial profiling is perpetrating because the RDO, the Racial Discrimination Ordinance, does not cover government powers and functions, hence directly excusing or justifying their act of racial profiling, and this brings into the question whether anyone is protected. Frankly speaking, what can the administrative guidelines do when there are so many gaps within the racial discrimination ordinance? Through this platform, we ask for three things. First, that the police exercise its powers reasonably and in a respectable manner, because such forms of behavior harms and creates misunderstandings in building good community relations between the government and the EM community. Second, we want that the police officials to keep a record of the people they choose to conduct the body ID and body searches on, and publish the statistics online. That way we can increase transparency. Third, we do not want any legal loopholes within the RDO, because the RDO is rendered ineffective since it does not cover the government functions and powers, which doesn't make the police accountable for racial profiling. Even here in today's public hearing, none of the police representatives are present. So how can they ensure racial equality if they don't feel like it is important to come to such a public hearing? Thank you for your time.
Thank you, Ms. Rama. Next, we have Ms. Sharma Mashroor, please.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Sharma, and I am a final year student reading social linguistics and comparative literature at the University of Hong Kong. My family is from Bangladesh, and we moved to Hong Kong when I was 3 years old. And like many of my colleagues on this floor have touched upon, there has been systematic linguistic exclusion. But that aside, many ethnic minorities in Hong Kong have had to deal with discrimination and employment here, even the ones who are fluent in Cantonese. Measures for ENs in employment only apply to base level service industry jobs in construction, hospitality, and retail. I understand that the Labor Department holds job fairs for EMs every other month in different districts. On its website, it states that vacancies suitable for ethnic minority job seekers will be arranged regularly at the job fairs. However, most of the jobs offered at these fairs require low skill, low education qualification, and pay low wages as a result. Yet, EMs, even the ones with master's degrees, are directed to these job fairs and told to go into the construction industry. Us minorities have a lot to offer to Hong Kong if we were simply given the chance. And a simple solution to this is to organize wider-ranging, more diverse career fairs for EMs, clearly keeping in mind the fact that ethnic minorities, especially those of us growing up in Hong Kong today and enrolling in universities and colleges now more than ever before, we all have far-reaching ambitions and must be encouraged as such from a young age. Sectors like IT, engineering, business, higher education, and media should be putting just as much focus into opening up access and distributing career information to EM job seekers, as well as going around to secondary schools when giving career talks. To achieve this end, the Labor Department needs to collect more thorough and complex data about what kinds of jobs ethnic minorities are seeking, rather than offering them basic services for predetermined job fields and categories based on their supposed ethnolinguistic background. The Racial Discrimination Ordinance was set up to protect and uphold the human dignity possessed by each and every single ethnic minority person living in the city, to make sure that we are treated as equals and given the same opportunities as whites and ethnic Chinese people in Hong Kong, so that we too have the chance to better our lives and increase our social mobility. Focusing only on the availability of interpretation services and spreading low-wage, low-skill jobs for minorities here feels more like a step backwards than actual initiative to ensure an equal and harmonious society for all, as stated repeatedly in the administrative guidelines and the RDO. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Mesro. We will now invite Ms. Arlene Rai.
Next, Ms. Arlene Rai.
A year three education major student. Now, the current guideline for education deals with Chinese as a second language curriculum, enhanced teacher training for those teaching NCS students Chinese, and providing funding. But I want to look at the points made on teacher training. The guidelines state that diversified and advanced development programs will be provided to raise their cultural and religious sensitivity. However, there's no detailed information on the topic of cultural awareness and sensitivity, with even the framework simply highlighting that it includes curriculum planning and learning, framework, teaching, and assessment stages. But it is not just the Chinese subject which has failed to integrate the ethnic community. The education system as a whole has not been able to maximize the learning environment for the EM students, with them underperforming compared to the local counterparts. This could be because of the teachers' lack of cultural awareness, as most of them are not even aware of their students' cultures and backgrounds, with most teachers not reaching the adaptation and integration stages of their ethno-relative state, which means having successful attempts and ability to incorporate their students' culture and experiences into the classroom to create an inclusive and optimal learning environment. The absence of this would mean students continue to feel alienated in the education system and see it as the teachers are not willing to understand them. Some teachers also demotivate EM students themselves by saying they have no future due to their poor academic results and their inability to speak fluent Cantonese. Even in my university, there's no strong emphasis on learning about the cultural diversity, though the topics of SENs and different types of learners are covered, meaning teachers in training are relatively aware on dealing with the above cases, and yet they're almost oblivious to the community surrounding them for more than a decade. Rather than just focusing on Chinese language, I think we should also focus on the education system as a whole to improve the understanding of EM students' needs in all subjects, with cultural sensitivity and awareness being a professional core course for all teachers in training, irrespective of the subject that they'll be teaching. Moreover, if we were to follow the guideline, perhaps a more strong emphasis and explanation on how they're going to increase the cultural and religious sensitivity needs to be discussed. Another way to do this would be to incorporate our ethnic culture into the test books that the students study. Why has the test books, especially for language subjects, failed to incorporate the ethnic culture ever so present in our society and instead focus on only the Western cultures and traditions? By doing so, this would allow students to learn more about the society that they live in and provide students and teachers the knowledge to be more culturally aware. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Rai. We will now invite Mr. Mohsin Khan, please.
Next, Ms. Rabia Aslam.
Education and Education University of Hong Kong. I'm here to talk about the applied learning Chinese, which is taught in senior secondary. I have studied that as well. This Chinese course lasts for about 2 years, and it's only provided to some ethnic minorities in Hong Kong. The difficulty level of this course is very high, higher than GCSE. The overall aim of this program is to teach some students Chinese language in service industry, but currently it's only about business and tourism. However, there are a number of problems that students are facing under this program. First, the teacher cannot provide explanations in English if the student don't understand the content in Chinese because the teacher is not proficient in English. We also don't know how to use Chinese dictionaries, and so we lack of understanding the Chinese characters' meaning if the teacher fails to provide that the accurate meaning in English. So the second problem is that the content that is taught in this course is not enough. Students expect more topics that are interesting to them, not just limited to business and tourism. Some students don't like business or tourism at all. So we should diversify it. It could be more diversified so that students can benefit more, as I mentioned, and learn more aspects under service industry, such as disciplinary forces, IT services, and so on. It will be more balanced if these topics could be covered, and it can also arouse students' interest in learning. Third problem is students find it less interactive, so their communication is in Chinese is too. It's not really improving, and it is a vocational based and service oriented program. So the communication should be the key area that should be focused at. So the teachers of this course don't really focus on the students' pronunciation of Chinese characters. However, in applied learning Chinese, the method that is currently used to teach Chinese is the same as the first language speakers. Just like the teacher regard us as a local, as a Chinese to teach us. But however, we are ethnic minorities, so Chinese is not our first language. The current Chinese as a second language learning framework is not working because there's no actual curriculum and teachers are not trained to teach Chinese as a second language. Instead, different methods should be used to teach Chinese as a first language and second language. There are two different methods. For second language, they should use romanization, that is called pinyin. So radical spousal, daily life conversations, and words with English meanings, and so on. For example, romanization is not currently taught at schools, And it is extremely important for second language learners to learn Pinyin if they want to be proficient in Chinese. This allows them to pronounce words accurately, just like a native speaker. This shows that though the administrative guidelines mention racially inclusive policy making, the EDB and the other public authorities still do not understand how to formulate policies that truly address the needs of ethnic minorities. Even though we all have these opinions and experiences with different aspects of the education system, how can we make sure that EDB hear us? Will the CMAB make EDB change its policies if they are found to be marginalizing and underserving ethnic minorities? Lastly, we hope that we can use these learning resources effectively and improve our Chinese so that we can also contribute to Hong Kong society in future. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Khan. We now invite Ms. Rabia Aslam, please.
Good afternoon, everyone. I am Rabia Aslam, a year one student studying mechanical and biomedical engineering at City University of Hong Kong. I migrated to Hong Kong almost 4 years ago with my family from Pakistan. At that time, as a new arrival in a city, I myself faced a lot of problems, from settling in a new and financially centered city to finding a good school to continue my education. When I came here, my parents faced a lot of difficulty in finding a good school for me and my siblings, despite our very high grades. No one guided me and my parents on how to look for a school. And this is not the only case with my family. In fact, a lot of ethnic minority students are facing this problem here in Hong Kong. I didn't know there was an initiation program from newly arrived children in Hong Kong at that time. But we didn't found about it, and no one guided us about this program. And that's why we ended up going to one of those so-called ethnic minorities designated schools, where I was told that it is really hard for me to go to any university in Hong Kong and to pursue my dream of getting a higher education. This is very common case in such schools because teachers equate students' capabilities according to their race, and this is indeed very demotivating for us students. I want to ask if there is any strategy on how will Education Bureau help or guide parents of newly arrived children. According to my research, I only found about one initiation program, this one. And I think this is not enough because this is not even well publicized. And how can it help newly arrived children when it is not well publicized? And this was actually introduced by EDP in 2000. And I want to ask one more question. Is there any data which government can provide to show that this program has actually fulfilled its objectives to enhance social adaption and enhance the standard of Chinese and English languages of those newly arrived students? I want to request government officials to focus more on providing really authentic support to newly arrived ethnic minorities, especially to their children if they are still school going or have a dream to go to university. Because it is not their fault, it is not our fault and not our parents' fault. We are in a totally different and new city. We need some support. It is clear that a society free of discrimination is a key to socioeconomic development. Hong Kong as a world city and home to thousands of migrants, government should do more to ensure inclusion for Chinese-speaking residents and empower them to lead a better life by providing more support to them in sense of helping them to easily adjust in a city which has a very diverse culture with huge problem of language barrier and racial discrimination. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Ms. Aslam. We will now invite Ms. Hannah Garong, please.
Thank you, Chairman. Good evening. My name is Suskiana Gurung, currently studying in the University of Hong Kong, studying literature and journalism. I am a Nepalese Hong Konger, born and raised here, and the granddaughters of two Gurkha soldiers. Today, I would like to present about the issues of the alternative Chinese exam ethnic minorities take in order to enter university. While the GCSE is great for newly arrived students, it is not so great for people like myself, as we are subjected to a low level of Chinese education for 12 years. I took the GCSE myself and earned the highest score, A star, along with almost all of my classmates, but we still cannot use Cantonese on an academic or working environment because of the low level of Cantonese tested on the exam. A lot of ethnic minorities have been taught the same basic topics every year since primary school, like where is the bus stop, something even a foreigner could learn in a day, but I am not a foreigner. I am rightfully a local who wishes to be able to communicate with our fellow citizens of all walks of life. Why are we pushed to achieve so low? I loved learning Cantonese when I was younger, but why did our learning stop at the basic level? We are often questioned about our identities as Hong Kongers because of our language ability, and even when we are able to speak it, we are ridiculed for not being able to read and write it. Not only is our identities attacked, we are left disadvantaged in employment. We can be highly qualified, but due to the fact that we are unable to speak Chinese, we are simply rejected, and it can also be used as an excuse when they do not want to hire someone of my ethnicity, hence showcasing that the alternative exam is not a long-term solution. Therefore, I would like to call for a reevaluation of the guidelines into whether the education system and the alternatives provided truly help us in the long term. The negative effects of the alternative exam is lifelong, as it affects not only our opportunity to learn Cantonese properly, but also our sense of belonging, job prospects, and our future. We believe that this is the result of poor policies that do not truly address such vital issues skin deep. Investing millions of money is not helpful if we cannot see any actual changes being made within the schools. Why is there no monitoring and no statistics or data to see if the current system is really working or not? It is going to be challenging and hard, but the children who are the future of Hong Kong at least deserve that much. We should be allowed a curriculum that starts from the primary school level and slowly increases in difficulty, that caters to different levels of ability, that would enable us to speak, read, write, and higher levels. We should not be segregated from our local Chinese friends. But instead taught together, providing a cultural education that benefits both parties. It has been 4 years since I graduated from secondary school. Why do the students continue to feel like nothing has changed and hopeless about their future in Hong Kong? I hope the younger generation has the right to a proper Chinese education where they can achieve any of their dreams and are not pushed into limited job opportunities. We should at least be given the opportunity to learn and receive quality education regardless of race, religion, gender, ability, or social class. This is basic humanity. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Gurung. And finally, for this session, we have Ms. Yasmin Zahira, please.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Zahira Yasmin. I'm a final year marketing student at Hong Kong Baptist University. Throughout my studies in Hong Kong, I've managed to grasp the proficiency in speaking Cantonese regardless of the setting. However, the corporate industry has a large demand for Mandarin speakers and Chinese typewriters. Knowing how to speak one of the Chinese language is not enough anymore. We are challenged to compete with native Mandarin speakers and fluent Chinese writers. My Chinese learning has been put on pause since secondary school after taking GCSE. There was no motivation from the school or the government policies for EM students to continue learning better Chinese after the fulfillment of minimum requirement. The government has failed us and done poorly under compulsory education system where we should learn to read, write, and speak fluent Chinese. Now it makes it even harder to acquire extra Chinese ability. Just this summer, while interning in an advertising firm, I felt myself at a disadvantage when tasks regarding Chinese research weren't assigned to me. After going back to school, I took up a non-credit-bearing Putonghua course in my university. It was a level one course. However, upon completion, I didn't sign up for further levels for the language. To fulfill my minimum requirement, taking extra course is to create an extra burden to the study schedule. My Chinese writing skills has worsened. Given the fact that I can only study either local Chinese level or beginner's level in schools, there isn't a curriculum or resources outside school I can turn to polish up my Chinese skills. I don't think I should be limited at my potential to the Chinese language in tertiary education. ERB's vocational Chinese training offers Putonghua learning restricted for workplace communications only. These courses are not addressing the reality of actual difficulties that EMs are facing if we are going to join the workforce soon. Also, such programs are hardly acknowledged by ethnic minority students, such as myself, that aren't meeting my schedule demands. I would suggest that the government should provide resources for ethnic minorities to well equip themselves for the uprising needs of Chinese writing and Mandarin speaking in the workplaces. It will be greatly appreciated if the government can consult on providing credit-bearing Chinese courses for ethnic minorities to continue their learning curve after secondary alternative Chinese learning. The curriculum of Chinese as second language learning should be reviewed and adapted to the needs of ethnic minority students. Also, such Chinese learning programs should be made known to the ethnic minority students through their tertiary education institutes. I hope to see actions taken to improve current situation. That's all I have to say. Thank you for listening.
Thank you, Mr. Hira.
As I understand, Ms. Andy Chen would like to provide a response first. I'd like to thank the 17 deputations who have spoken, including the students. So first of all, I'd like to thank you for all your views. Since time is limited for very specific matters with relation to certain departments, I might invite representatives from different departments to respond, but I'd like to offer an overall response. I've heard some very clear calls or requests, including the provision of services by departments and the collection of data on the services provided to EMs from different departments. And I see that the HA has done substantial work on this. This is indeed a very good suggestion. We will look at the issue with various departments to see if this is indeed difficult. And I'm quite optimistic of that. As for the extent of the interpretation services provided, we heard some very specific comments. So again, we would look at that too. One of the deputations said that our administrative guidelines are not uploaded online, but the fact is it's already online and it's in Chinese, English, and 6 EM languages. A checklist of measures from different authorities have also been uploaded to our website in Chinese, English, and the 6 EM languages. So the information is accurate as of the end of last year. So we are looking at very up-to-date information. In terms of legislation, we had a discussion recently on this, and the government is following up on this. As for whether there would be a higher level committee, because there are views that our guidelines are not legally binding, and the efforts seem to be lacking. I want to clarify that the administrative guidelines were passed by the highest level of the government, and we have a policy committee headed by the Chief Secretary. So the guidelines are binding to government departments. And as for whether we can further reinforce our efforts is something we can look at. Since time is limited, the first session should last till 5:40, and we still have a second session. So three members would like to speak. 3 minutes each, please. Ms. Alice MAK. Chairman, I'd like to thank the deputations for offering their views. There is a lot I want to say, and 3 minutes would not be enough for me to say everything and address what everyone has said. I prepared a written document on our requests and recommendations on the guidelines. According to the Undersecretary and deputations, there are 2 points I want to raise. many people talked about setting up a high-level committee, and this is something we should continue to fight for. But there are two specific areas which require follow-up. In paragraphs 13 and 15 of the paper, relevant figures were quoted, and the Undersecretary said the HA produced some very good numbers. For example, more than 10,000 sessions of interpretation were provided, but it's not just about the number of sessions provided, but the variety of the ethnic minorities served. I told Dr. Cheng on another occasion that if you are serving 15,000 people and you provided 10,000 sessions of interpretation, that would be great. But if you are talking about a service target of 200,000 odd people, then providing just 10,000 sessions would be too little. And most departments do not have statistics on the service EMs, so there's no way to evaluate whether the services provided to EMs is enough or what would be enough. So that's why these numbers are important. When we, some departments indicated that they are worried that compiling these figures might constitute discrimination. So I want to clarify that such figures do not serve to discriminate, but to ascertain the service level. For interpretation service, we indeed the HA is doing a very good job. So you have a good system and good guidelines, but what about the frontline workers? There's an application form in English for patients to apply for interpretation service. So if patients do not know English, what can they do? When we work with the cases, some nurses wrote on the back of the patients some sheets, reminding them to bring their families or friends who understand Cantonese next time. So if interpretation service is readily available, why would nurses need to issue such reminders? When we meet EM patients, we would ask whether they know there are interpretation services and whether they know they can request such services. So I think 6 or 7 out of 10 do not know of such services. And I've seen a recent case like that. So we have the guidelines in place, and according to the paper, the government would seek to unify the standard procedures and guidelines. And but this is not the end of the story. You have to make sure that frontline workers are complying with the guidelines. Ms. Claudia Mo.
Exhausting, isn't it? We're here to set up this special committee to help doggedly defend the rights of ethnic minorities in Hong Kong. Acquiescence on the part of the government is simply not enough. You can't just sit there saying, yes, we could do better until next time. Time and again, I mean, all these familiar faces, all these familiar topics. So please, I'm not trying to conduct your business for you. I'm not running the government's business for them. But you should know what's been happening, and you should translate words into actions and not just words. I've just tabled this motion, please, urging the government to quickly, as soon as possible, review and amend the racial discrimination ordinance to make sure that government powers and functions are no longer exempted. I mean, you listen to those, not just allegations, the accusations against unwarranted police body the searches and ID checks. And the learning of Chinese as a second language, really. second language. Just imagine if our children would need to learn English like a first language, how are our children going to cope? Things like that. Okay, I did hear the government representative saying something like, yes, we'll look into the racial discrimination ordinance thing, but we can't promise any timetable. That's what he said, in effect. Please, can we have some sort of timetable? I'm not even seeking a deadline. I mean, I don't want to stay at this Legislative Council for another 2 years. And the next term, people will ask the same questions yet again. Timetable, please.
Undersecretary, can you offer a holistic response at the end? Dr. Fernando Chang. Thank you, Chairman. I'd like to thank the deputations for being here to discuss the administrative guidelines. Under the Race Discrimination Ordinance, the EOC recommended applying the ordinance to the government, but the government still decides to exempt itself from the law, so it prefers to be above the law and unbounded.
其中是一個緊急和重要的修訂,政府不肯。其中一個藉口就是說有這個指引。這個指引都搞了很久了,執行很順利。但是你發覺這個指引做了出來之後呢?
The guidelines have been implemented very smoothly, but then what happens is that there are more and more bureaus and departments that are prepared to accept the adoption of the guidelines, and yet nobody was there to monitor the implementation. We have had discussions on this years ago, and we've also asked the administration to monitor the implementation of the guidelines, and supposedly it's the CMAB, which is responsible for the monitoring of the implementation of the set of guidelines, and now the government is here, and they are saying that, well, why don't we ask the departments and the groups to see if there are any statistics available. So apparently this is a problem. It did only prop up today. But my question is, well, for this set of guidelines, other than the fact that they've been placed here, and also we can also tell the UN that we have introduced this, or is just there as window dressing, what exactly does it do in terms of actual implementation? How can we find out if the departments have complied with the set of guidelines and so on? And if they fail to comply, then what can be done about it? So have they done anything like that? And can they tell us the result of such a survey and so on? Okay, so we still have some time to go. Undersecretary, would you like to respond? Or would you like to answer all the questions at the end of the meeting? So there'll be another session, so you will still have time. So Undersecretary, would you like to respond now? You just told me that, well, I had 30 seconds left. All right, I'll respond at the end of the next session. Yes, Mr. Eddie Chu. Thank you, Chairman. In fact, I've heard this time and again. And my understanding is that there are two main problems. One is education. That is how you can make sure that EM children, even if they are born in Hong Kong, how they can get better language education so that they can better integrate into Hong Kong society. And the second one is also language related. That is, while government departments are providing services and so on, so how can you ensure that friends from ethnic minority groups will be able to get your services without any barriers, in particular language barriers? So my next question would be more practical. All right, you have so many departments represented here. Do you know every year how much is spent by the administration on helping the EMs to break through such language barriers? So how much is being spent by these departments and bureaus on this? And also, what's the future trend like this? Is it that they're spending more? Or is it that, all right, I'll be doing more, and yet I've not spent anything more? And if you don't have extra money, then how can you do more? I remember at the CE's question time, Mr. Abraham Shek suggested that we should set up a $500 million fund in your recurrent expenditure. So how much exactly have you been spending on this? And also, if you were to set up a dedicated fund, when are you going to do that? We're going to discuss the budget shortly. So can you give us a more specific response? Yes, Undersecretary, would you like to reply overall? Yes. Yes, Mr. Poon Siew Peng. I'm very pleased to see so many young people from the EMs who have been able to tell us their views. In fact, that's very constructive because for EMs to be able to integrate into society would be very important to Hong Kong society. Anyway, just now the Undersecretary also said that the administrative guidelines have been in place for some 8 years, involving some 23 government departments and bureaus. And according to the deputations, their criticism is that your bureau, in coordinating the implementation and monitoring of the implementation of the guidelines, has a lot to be desired. Okay, you're still listening to the views, and there are some deputations who have suggested. I'm not sure if the administration has considered this. And of course, to ask the CS4 administration to lead this high-level task force, there are also requests for an interdepartmental group to be set up so that for anything relating to EM matters, it should be coordinated by a commissioner. So have you thought about this? And also in para 16, you also talk about the way forward. It says that the CMAB and the relevant authorities will be reviewing the guidelines on a regular basis. In particular, you would also be looking at how the existing services can be enhanced and introduce new measures that would promote racial equality. I'd like to know, for these departments, well, there are 23, so have they come up with new services that will be rolled out shortly? So can you tell us more about that? Next, Abraham Shek.
One of you. You are as much a Hong Kong citizen as we are all. And I totally believe that education is a right. Equality in education is also your right. So instead of spending my time talking something that you have eloquently spoken of, I give my time to EDB to answer your questions so that you go home with some hope. EDB, please answer, particularly the question raised by Ms. Gurung. Please answer her in English, by courtesy.
Either way, please.
Okay. Thank you for the questions and our views on education support for ethnic minority students. All along, it is the education policy to support non-Chinese speaking students to integrate into our society and to enable them to learn Chinese as well as adapt to the education system of Hong Kong. So starting from 2014, we have implemented a series of enhanced measures to support Chinese language learning of the non-Chinese speaking students. The learning framework, which was implemented in 2014-15 school year, provides a framework for schools to cater for the needs of the non-Chinese speaking students according to their ability. And every year, the government provides enhanced funding to schools admitting students with 10 or above non-Chinese speaking students, which is quite a large amount of money. In terms of teacher training, we also arrange a lot of courses for teachers to equip them on teaching Chinese as a language, as a second language. Besides, we also arrange seminars with EOC every year to promote integration in the setting of schools. In the school curriculum, there is also different subject and in different modules, starting from primary education to senior secondary, emphasizing the core values of harmony among different races, as well as respect
Chairman,
students of different backgrounds.
She's using my time, I urge her to answer the question raised by a number of speakers here. Just telling us the policy is no good because the policy is not working. So please answer the question from Ms. Gurung, Ms. Aslam, as they have raised earlier, please.
Ms. Chen, you want to respond to that?
Regarding the question raised by the students, they are talking about the Chinese standards, how to provide them with more opportunities to enhance the learning of Chinese. I think we now have a different alternate pathways to enable students to acquire their Chinese language qualifications for admission to university. After the graduation, there are also various opportunities to further their advancement in the Chinese qualifications.
Chairman, I would raise this question in a Q&A, sure, in the normal urban council,
yeah,
council meeting, okay?
Right, appreciate that. 跟着我们请张丽云.
Next, Anne Chiang. Thank you, Chairman. Well, for the DAB, during the past 10 plus years, we have done a lot of work concerning studies on EMs and also services for EMs. In fact, we have actually set up an EM center specifically for the ethnic minorities. And just now, Mr. Abraham Shek talked about Chinese as a second language and how it should be taught. And our former chairman, or former president, Mr. Jasper Zhang, had been asking for that for a long time. And today, I heard many deputations say that when it comes to learning Chinese, well, schools have not been successful in promoting the learning of Chinese. So I hope that the EDB or the administration can respond to this. Well, every year, if I remember it correctly, well, in 2014, some $200 million was spent, and every school with more than 10 EM students will mean that the schools will have to provide guidance on their learning of Chinese. So what's the effect? How effective has it been? So that's point number one. And number two is about interpretation services at hospitals. I've also personally accompanied some EM friends to hospitals. And I remember on those occasions, well, at the hospital, we needed to wait. As to how long we had to wait, well, after waiting for a while, somebody would come in to provide the service. But then today, I heard some deputations said that it's not available. So why was that the case? Was it that there was no interpreter available? It's not possible. It's not acceptable because Hong Kong is a metropolis. So how many visitors are here in Hong Kong? Not everybody can speak English. So we need to have interpreters who can speak in several languages. So how come that's not available? So I hope that the HA can respond to that. Last but not least, Chairman, well, a year before last, I actually moved a motion and I asked the Labour Department to hire some non-ethnic Chinese so that they can help the EMs when they try to find jobs. But then just now from what I heard, yes, that's available, but then it's not in-depth enough and it's also not able to provide them with a lot of guidance. So can you enhance the service so that they at least know that there are certain jobs that might fit them? So I hope that the Labour Department can also respond to that. Thank you. Mr. Wen Xiuqing. Thank you, Chairman. On this particular subject, the DP shared the views of many colleagues. Well, at this meeting and others, we have already said many times that for the lack of services for the EMs or lack of support for them, it's also an indirect way of discrimination. I think there is no dispute about that. So I'm not going to state my stance. I'm just asking some practical questions. It's about the housing department. In the past, they have claimed that they provide interpretation services, but then according to my statistics, only 12 sessions were arranged. So that's for the last 3 years. So which departments and also which bureau is responsible for monitoring this? So have you faced up to this? And equally important, I think during this term and last term, some colleagues have also asked the same question. You do have this, you use the video camera to provide video interpreting services. So given the low utilization rate, there must be a reason for this. So how come this is public money funded services and nobody is using it? There must be a reason behind this. And yet despite their calls, no improvement has been made. So this is really a serious problem. And also another problem with the housing department. Well, we have received many government correspondence or letters which are in both Chinese and English. All right, that's the case. And I remember one of the panels also criticized that they do issue or send out letters in English. But then we question that because very often it's in Chinese only. But then Hong Kong is a place where both Chinese and English are official languages. All right, we are not talking about ethnic minority languages. How come for official correspondence, how come they are not in both Chinese and English? And also, it's very strange. The SWD also talk about video interpreting. In overseas countries, many EMs, and in many of those communities, they would specifically hire EMs to provide relevant social services. But then I don't think that's the case or policy trend in Hong Kong. So I'd like to know whether or not that will be the consideration by the SWD. Will that be introduced? I agree with some colleagues who said earlier that if you just rely on filing complaints with the EOC, it's not going to work. I don't know how they should be filing their complaints. Well, maybe, as Mr. Poon Siew Ping just suggested, we should have a commissioner on ethnic minority groups. That's one way to go about it. And we've also got district officers. Well, it's difficult to ask them to take on board this as their responsibilities. But then we also have ADOs. So can we ask the ADOs to deal with that?
This is certainly possible. We can ask the ADOs to look after their own districts, and that way support can be enhanced. The government always stressed that they would communicate with leaders or elders of EMs. But why aren't the government responding to their calls? So hopefully the government can address most, if not all, of my questions. Mr. Dan Squaw.
What my friend Abraham Shack has said, that we are all Hong Kong citizens. We are all entitled to education, especially for our next generation. And our children are entitled to the same services that government has to offer. So having heard what all of you have said regarding the present situation, it seems that there's only one way to force the government to provide equal services and education to citizens of all kind in Hong Kong, which is to make sure the government would have a legal obligation to do what they are required to do under this failing policy. So I just want to ask, is there any plan in which we would bring the government powers and responsibility within the racial discrimination ordinance, within the ambit of the ordinance, so that the government would have clear obligations to act fairly and equally towards citizens of all kind? They are all Hong Kong people, and they should deserve equal and fair treatment.
Since time is limited, there are a lot of questions to be answered by the Undersecretary, and since deputations for the next session are already waiting, please offer a quick response. The speaker is not coming through. Can a written answer be requested? A lot of issues have been raised today. I think it would be unfair to if we leave their questions hanging, so we must give them an answer. So if you cannot finish, please provide a written answer. I realize time is limited, but with so many deputations here, I hope they can hear an answer before they leave. If I miss anything, we can provide a written answer. The government is steadfast in eliminating racial discrimination and promoting equal opportunities. So these are our policy objectives. And the chief executive reiterated this in her policy address, and four paragraphs were dedicated. I think we can all agree on the direction. It's just about the the amounts of work or intensity of work. We have more than 80,000 EM persons, and together with other ethnicities, we might have a few hundred thousand. We are a Chinese society, but it's but we are proud of welcoming other races to Hong Kong, and the government is obliged to help them call this place home and for them to be happy and contribute to Hong Kong. This would benefit the EMs as well as our society as a whole. So we are committed at the government. So we certainly welcome your ideas. I think there are a few major categories. One, working on the system or the laws, and two, the regular monitoring, and number three, the services. As for our system, we promote equal opportunities in three by three means. First, through our laws, we had a lot of discussions, and we agree that our laws must move with the times. So we are drafting legislation on the nine priority areas identified by the EOC. As for whether the government's functions and powers should be bounded by the LDO, first of all, the government is bounded by the HKBOLO. The LDO does not completely exclude government departments. As we said in the paper, certain functions and powers of the government are bounded, and certain services are regulated. After we complete the nine priority areas, we would assess the remaining dozen or so legislative suggestions. So this is what I briefed everyone already last November. So we should focus on the first stage before we can know the timeline or the procedures going forward. That would be a more responsible approach. As for regulation, Dr. Fernando Chang asked what the guidelines are for. To be fair, the guidelines have 11 pages excluding the annexes. So if you follow the guidelines, you would not head the wrong way. So the guidelines provide a direction for new staff, and so it is useful to have something to refer to. And some people said that different government departments have different practices, and this is the flexibility afforded by the guidelines, and appropriate policies are possible for different government departments. It's about striking a balance between both. So in our review exercise, we will seek to be more comprehensive, and we will consider the views given today, and we would incorporate those as appropriate. And the guidelines have all also been uploaded online, and a checklist of measures from each department is to be uploaded online in Chinese, English, and 6 EM languages, covering most native tongues of South Asians. So there's also competition between different government departments, and there is positive competition. But as the policy bureau, would the CMAB be more proactive? This is something we will look at. And I'd like to name some departments: the HA, Labor Department, Education Bureau, Housing Department. Since we do not want the deputations for the next round wait too long, please provide a very brief answer, around 1 minute each. Who would go first? Dr. Anne Chang talked about DHA's interpretation services. All the public hospitals and clinics under DHA provide interpretation services for EMs. Our services are offered through contractors, court interpreters, volunteers, or staff. The services are provided around the clock. And for consultations with bookings, the service could also be booked. For emergency cases, since we have a 24-hour hotline, we will try to offer telephone interpretation if possible, or we would ask the interpreter to come to the A&E room. So we have 18 EM languages. In the last financial year, we provided more than 12,000 sessions of simultaneous interpretation. Next, who will go next? Labor Department. Thank you very much for the question from Dr. Cheng. As to the hiring of staff who understand EM, apart from EM ambassadors, starting from May last year, we hired two assistants who are familiar with EM languages. So going forward, we will look to enhance our measures or reinforce the service provision. Mr. Fong from the Housing Department. The speaker is not coming through. In terms of applications, they can choose the communication language. They can choose Chinese or English, and future correspondence will be conveyed in the preferred language. Last year, we only had 12 cases involving simultaneous interpretation. In other words, when conducting the CAS, 12 sessions of simultaneous interpreting were requested. With regards to the $2 million provision starting from the school year 2014-15, for schools that admit more than 10 non-Chinese speaking students, there would be a funding. This year, 228 schools have received funding, and starting from 2014-15, the funds would be included in the school report and proposal on how they establish this learning network and promote racial harmony. So we would monitor the work of the schools. And generally speaking, most schools would use 10% of the funding to hire interpreters or EM teaching assistants. So in terms of the teaching effectiveness, every year we commission a tertiary institute to talk about the overall response or performance. As for the measures, we have established a study framework, and we will continue to collect data . And there will be quantitative and qualitative indicators according to the experts. And we will report the progress in a timely manner to members. Since time is limited, I think we will bring this session to an end. So we will take a 3-minute break to prepare for the next session. Thank you.